My name is Jeff Medier from the University of Rochester, and I want to welcome you to our sixth Tableau Upstate New York group session here. Today is a really nice session because we've had a guest presenter who's going to take us through his experiences with Tableau, Adam Crahan. We're also going to be talking a little about breaking out into focus groups at some point. So for many of you who have been using Tableau, whether it be for a week, a month, a year, 5 years, you may have some areas of interest that you want to focus on, or maybe you come to this meeting looking for answers. And hopefully in this session, we'll be able to at least get you associated with folks who can give you some answers potentially, or people to partner with. So I just want to thank you for it. A couple of reminders, again, if you need any water or refreshments, they're just outside in the hallway. The restrooms, we do have the signs posted just outside the door, as well as your typical airport exit doors. If anything happens, go that way. And there's also a back door entrance at the top of the stairs here. We're going to be recording this session, not to put it up on YouTube for everyone to see, but for us just to be able to record our presentations. And did everybody find that the Eventbrite invitation method was a good way to sign up for this session? So that was a new ad. We've also registered a Twitter account, so now you can tweet us. However the heck you tweet us, you can tweet us now. So I want to thank Chris Daly. Chris Daly is a co-op that had come on to the University of Rochester to work in our team for the visualizers, and he's introduced us to some 21st century technology, getting me out of the paper and pen mode that sometimes I get into. So thank you, Chris, for helping us get organized here with this. So let's eat our own dog food, shall we? So when we start looking at who are the folks that make up this tug with the responses that we got from everybody, it's very interesting to see, and pardon the bias there in the middle about the University of Rochester, but this is the most diverse crowd that we've had involved in our tugs since we started. We started out around the 20, 25 user group sessions. Today we're close to 100 if everybody shows up for it. And that's very, very warming, very heartening for a lot of us because we've been evangelizing the use of Tableau for multiple reasons, for multiple visualizations, for multiple reporting solutions, not just here at the University of Rochester, but for a lot of you out in your local companies, your local areas of expertise, to make people realize you can do more than just look at 2D diagrams, that there is a life after Excel for a lot of our stuff. So that's a great thing for us to be able to share with folks. And as I mentioned before, part of our agenda that we'll go through is to be able to have people associate with others for common areas, common issues, common themes, whether you want to know more about a specific Tableau function, whether more you want to know about specific domain type activities, what's going on in the education world, what's going on in the manufacturing world, the banking world. So a lot of that is going to be, hopefully, a result of your contributions to today's session. And these groups are not like, we have them here today, we'll never have them here again. These groups will hopefully have some roots that we'll be using these groups reoccurring going forward, for folks to be able to share what they can do. Because I would like to get additional presenters out of this activity. When we first started, it felt like the U of R show. We wanted to hurry up and get away from that. So we were happy to have Adam here today. We've got a person from Syracuse that expressed interest for our next session. Please feel free, based on your comfort level, based on the message you're trying to send with Tableau, and based on your data sensitivity or insensitivity, what you would be able to share with us. Here in our group, so we can try to learn and benefit from each other's experiences with Tableau. So again, if we look at the bubbles, I think we were somewhere around 20, 25 different companies, somewhere around there, ranging anywhere from 1 to 34 participants. So again, thank you for coming to this. We'll keep updating this bubble chart as we go. Helps if you go to the right computer. So our agenda today, just a brief welcome. Then we'd like to have Adam Crahan do his presentation for us. And then we'll have a brief intermission. And then we'll discuss about breakout teams, trying to illustrate areas that people are interested in having other people commiserate or share ideas for what they can do. We'll talk very little probably about the Tableau 10.2 release, other than letting you know that yes, there is a Tableau 10.2. It will hit when you least expect it. We are thankful enough to also have in the room Tableau representation, Brian Seely, who's from Tableau. He is our Upstate New York sales representative. Or what's the best way to phrase it?
I'm not the sales rep, I'm the consultant.
Okay, so we can talk to him.
Yeah.
Good. Because if you talk to the sales rep, you'll have to buy a license. continue to solicit presentation ideas for our next session, whether it be a result of your discussions in your focus groups, or again, if you do want to, feel free to share with your presentations, and then we'll have a brief closing, okay? So that's what the agenda is currently going to look like for today. So let's introduce our guest presenter, Adam. So Adam has a biography of senior citizen. Sorry, I'm trying to turn senior citizens on the template to them, so that'll be our next user group in here. So from the Department of Interior, he's got over 100 visualizations to his name that he's shared out on Tableau and Tableau Public, and a very, very strong ambassador, as you would call it, an evangelist of Tableau, and not necessarily limited to just a Tableau platform, but things that work well with Tableau or help prepare Tableau data, and then as an action blocker here. So Adam, I'm gonna work on switching over computers and see how this works out.
Yes. Yeah. What is pasteurization? It's okay. We'll stop.
So much pressure.
No, sorry. Very well done. I will give you a doctor's up if you want. So, 50 seconds. Are you okay up there? Or you want to come closer? Okay. All right. So, I'm going to reset that. So, we'll just write down 50 and 1, 2, 3, go.
I hope you didn't cheat.
Oh, wait. I screwed it up. We're not, but what I wanted to do is say, next, I was going to give you a little bonus. I was going to give you some color. So this is a pre-attentive attribute. This is one of the things that I learned about at the Capitol Conference. So just knowing how the brain will identify things with color, shape, size, angle, those kinds of things. I'm not going to ask you to count with that one because you'd get about roughly half the time of the original. I'm going to actually give you a bonus. All right, you ready?
Yeah.
Okay, 1, 2, 3, go. Yeah, you done? Oh, okay. We'll take off 2 seconds. What'd you get? 17. Okay. So there are 17 number fours in the group. So this is on a tablet public, so if you're ever struggling with people at work who are saying, I don't really care about your visualization stuff, just give me the spreadsheet, ask them to go up here and do this. Just tell them to time themselves. They can do it 3 times, you know, without the color, with the color, with the size. I guarantee you they will cut their time in half by adding color and probably about a quarter of the time if you add the size. I usually make people leave the room though.
You don't have to do that.
Okay, so back to practicing. After I left Tableau Conference, I wanted to start a Tableau doctoral program at Interior. I wanted to help build our own community. I thought I was pretty good at it. I had just spoke at the conference. And so I thought, before I do that, I'm gonna test myself a little bit. Do I really know what I'm talking about? So I went out to Tableau community. There's over 100,000 passionate users. So I said, okay, I'm gonna try this. And that's what I did. For about 6 months last year, I was answering questions. I may have answered some of yours if you posted anything. And I got up to they rate you, you get little points. So I got up to the Data Monarch score, and in 4 months they have a little top. They have a little top thing down here. Where is it? Oh, they have a leaderboard. They're calculating. But I was in the top 10 after 4 months for everybody. I had never been on there before, so I felt pretty good. Felt like I could really start to go out there. And this is where I learned everything. People will ask the craziest questions, and this is where you'll think about it and say, how will you do that? Yeah, how do you do that? And then I'll try to figure it out. And something interesting happened as I was doing this, people started noticing me on the forums, and I started getting requests to talk at different conferences. And one of the girls who was number 2 at the time, I believe, Pooja, reached out to me, and she's like, hey, you're doing really good. Now at the time, every time you go to answer, you got to be quick because somebody else will answer. And you know, anybody ever see Seinfeld with Newman? I'd be writing my answer, putting screenshots in. She was out there. She always beat me. She was always right. You know, one time I even wrote an LOD answer, and she went out. And said, you could do that better. So anyway. We kind of got to talking, and through the forums, we ended up starting the blog together. So I'll have more about that in a second. I did start that Tableau doctor program. I had just did my 59th appointment yesterday. These are the different bureaus within Interior. And I just start to track, because I track everything now. I started to track the number of appointments, the number of people. I do one-on-one help with people at Interior, and they send me their workbook. But I allow people to sit in and learn. So we have trying to help build that community. So we have a group of observers. I track all that information. It's not lost on me that I have best practices in a word cloud, but I don't know how else to visualize all of those things. I have 585 symptoms remedied, but there's 108 distinct things I've helped people with in the interior. So from there, I'm starting to work on the forums. I'm doing this forum type work at work. I wanted to practice the visualization skills. So where do you go for that? Okay, has anybody ever heard of Makeover Monday? A couple people. If you don't know Makeover Monday, you should. This is the single best way to learn Tableau. The URL is makeovermonday.co.uk. It's run by Andy Kriebel and Eva Murray. It was run last year by Andy Cotgrove as well. Eva stepped in this year. What they do is every Sunday they publish a data set out on their site. There's some rules out there you can read when you go out there. And they will publish a data set, a link to an article. It's typically got a bad chart in it. Sometimes they're good, sometimes they're bad. And what they do is they ask people, if they want, go out and visualize it. Tell your story. What would you have done with the data? And last year, there were about 60 people on average submitting every week. So it's the single best way to learn because you will get 60 different takes of the same data set. And you cannot get that anywhere else. So they posted this weekly. There's 52 2016. They're doing it again this year. And I'm going to show you some of mine. I mean, I've done all of them. Pooja has done all of them. Pooja. And it really is the best place to learn. So I recommend you go out and take a look at that. The Tableau community is really active on Twitter. So this is all kind of get shared through Twitter. So people post pictures and links. Andy even tracks, the guy that runs it, even tracks who submits and how many, and so he has stats. And I think last year this was nominated for an Info is Beautiful Award. It was for a data project and it got an honorable mention. So go out to Makeover Monday. I'm going to show you some of that. This is our Data Duo blog. This is our responsive gallery here. We have over 200 visualizations between Pooja and myself. And I'm going to just click on Makeover Monday here. These are all the ones that we have done. There's 59, so we have 118 Makeover Monday visualizations. And I guarantee you I learned something in each one of these. So I'm going to show you a couple. This one I got a visit today. I was practicing designing for mobile. I think it just got a visit of the day because I stuck a gift in there. So this was actually celebrating Alan Rickman's career and works on your phone. So you get the GIF, which is cool. I was really, anybody like Die Hard too? Yeah, Die Hard. Die Hard fans. All right. So he was, a lot of his money came in the adventure category, but there was kind of this perception in the data that his highest grossing movies were characters where he portrayed a villain or a dark character. And so I tried to do that with the line chart there. So he was Sheriff of Nottingham, Hans Gruber from Die Hard, Snape in the Harry Potter movies. And you can even click on that, and you'll get kind of a visual indicator. You may not be able to read that well. It's designed for a phone. So that was one of my recommendations. Let's see, that's another good one. Is visualizing the gender gap in Australia. And I just wanted to play with radio bar chart. It's visualizing over 1,000 different careers. So each one of these bars represents an occupation. And the length of the line represents the salary difference between males and females. If the line is going away from the circle, that means males make more money. If the line is going in the circle, that means females make more money. Now, one of the Zen masters wrote a blog about this data set because it was all using averages and said it was flawed. But I wasn't really trying to make any judgments on the data. I really just want to make radio archer. So that's what I was playing with there. So you do get the overall impression there's not a lot of females making more money in Australia. You can also sort this by salary difference, and it becomes a little bit more clear. So there's just a few lines going in the center. So that was one, and I'll show you one more. This one had to do with the, it's kind of rendering weird, Tableau Public had to install an update 2 days ago, and it occurred to me everything. Okay, we're going to look at Steph Curry. Do we have any basketball fans? Okay. I don't know why these are small on with the projector, but so this was looking at Steph Curry. Was looking at, I think it was through 25 games or so. And, oh, this is mine. That's Bougie's. She's always trying to one up. Okay. All right, so this is mine. So we were analyzing whether or not, so this is through 35 games, and even had a note on there. So Steph Curry is a bad man. He is the best three-point shooter. You can see he does not take a lot of mid-range jump shots. Somebody even processed this data set so you can see where he took that shot from. It'll even highlight on the line chart, tell you what game it was, who was defending him, what second in the game, and all of that. So that's using some background images. So again, some fun data sets to play with for practice. So definitely go out, take a look at Makeover Monday. So through Makeover Monday, that's when our blog was born in April last year. And really, it was Pooja forcing me into it, which is kind of funny, you'll see in a second. And she wanted to start this blog really for something called Iron Viz. Has anybody ever heard of that? So at the Tableau conference, they have something called Iron Viz. Crazy people will submit visuals. Crazy people will submit visualizations, and there's 3 feeder contests, and then they have 20 minutes to build a visualization in front of thousands of people at the conference. So who would want to do that? Well, apparently, if you write a blog along with your post, you have a better chance of winning. So Pooja won't force me into starting a blog. So I'm going to show you a couple of our visualizations. These are all of the ones. Click Iron Viz at the top. You'll see which ones we submitted. This was the first contest in April. It was my first blog post, and hopefully public will launch it. There it is. I have a crazy brother-in-law from Texas who grows peppers in the backyard here in Rochester. He gets some mailed, seeds mailed. And he grew some Carolina Reapers and he made me eat it. So I've eaten that one and it's hot. Surprise. So I did this hot Red Hot Chili Peppers of the World visualization. I actually grouped them by what country they're in. This little slope chart here shows the min and the max Scoville units, which is just a name for how hot it is. And it talks a little bit about the Scoville units, and I have a picture of each. So you can come over here and highlight over that, and it will automatically update and show you the new information. You could click on, say, a country, and it would highlight on the chart. So these are the hottest peppers in the United States. You can see on average, they're pretty low. They're not super, super hot overall. And you can hover over then this chart and see, well, which ones are there. So the second one comes from the US as well. Here's the habanero mustard, and so what I was really starting to realize was that Trinidad, if I can find it here, had the hot ones. Well, trust me, Trinidad has like the top 6 or 7 in the top 10. And so this was my biz. I didn't get picked. Russell Spangler produced a sushi biz where he drew polygons of sushi, which is insane, and he won that contest. But our blog was born. The next one happened, and it was about politics. about politics, so I started to look through that, and surprisingly, it wasn't that interesting. So I ended up ditching that. And so what happened was the Orlando massacre happened at that time, and so I thought, you know, I'm going to talk about like some gun control visualization. So I went out, I found a data set on Mother Jones, other different information about assault weapons ban, and some data from the New York Times. And I thought I would do something nobody else was doing, is I'll design it as mobile view. So this is a 4,000 pixel long dashboard. It's the Tableau Max, unless you hack the workbook. And so this just kind of tells a story. And that's what I was going for, is telling a data story, getting better at getting people to see what you're trying to say. So this started, I went to an Edward Tufte training class, so I had Sparklines on my mind, so I started with Sparklines. Just talking about the number of people that passed away, the number of victims moving down. I started to then analyze the types of guns that were banned. I started to play with YouTube parameters. So that video is actually like 5 minutes long, but now I learned how to use YouTube parameters to show just a couple seconds of that embedded in the viz. It works really good on mobile because on a mobile device, YouTube videos go full screen. So when you tap that, it goes full screen, you hit done, you're back at the visualization where you were. I started to look at why these guns were legal. And so you can see here, I actually visualized the 2013 Senate vote that was looking at the assault weapons ban. So this used some math that Adam McCann, who's a Zen Master, had out there. He did the Beatles viz and the Game of Thrones. So this was using some of the math that he had in that viz to visualize the arc of the vote. And I even created a way where you could pick a state. So we're in New York, so we'll click on New York. So that will add some emphasis to the two senators there. And you can then find them really quickly and see how they voted. The vote was 60 to 40 no. Then I started to analyze whether they were Democrats or Republicans. I went back through, this is during the election, so I started looking at what the candidates were saying using those YouTube parameters. I did a 100 unit ASCII text chart that Robbie Zakovich created last year. He was named the Zen Master. Worked with me briefly at Interior. And then there was talk of a ban of, you know, the Muslim religion back in the throughout the race for the White House. So I actually started to analyze the race. Well, who is completing these shootings? And so 60% of the shooters were white, only 5 were Muslim. And so I went through, I visualized where they were happening, even created, you know, links to the data sources. And this site doesn't work anymore, but if you hit this link, it would take you to a second dashboard. And embedded here was a way that you could fill out your absentee vote, because Tableau Conference was during the week of the election. I thought I was onto something, and I did not win that. Robert Bruce, who's a Zen Master, created this awesome political divide dashboard. He was nominated for an info, this beautiful, beautiful award. I think the Washington Post published it. So I did not have a chance. All right. So those are all some fun visualizations that I started to play with. Some of these are serious. Some are fun. Makeover Monday. But all of them are getting back to work. So how do you now take this stuff to work? So let's look at a couple of visualizations for Interior. Don't tell them. Okay. This is one that I created this year. So one of the things we do in the government, we do a really good job of tracking costs and reporting on our costs. We don't do a really good job of telling anybody what they got for that money. And so our deputy CFO, this was his idea. This is the second year we've published a visualization like this. I think this one's way better. Each one I get better at. And so what I did is, it's actually a dashboard of our 9 different bureaus. And what I did is I took screenshots of each of them and created custom icons to trying to get people to go to the other tabs. The first year we did this, we stuck our bureau logos up there. That tab's got like 1,000 views. The other tabs have almost none. So people aren't going to these other tabs. So I was trying to generate some buzz with the links. Also, you'll notice these aren't super business dashboards. They're a little bit more like Makeover Monday style dashboards. I don't think people are looking at government data unless they have an interest. So these ones have a little bit more flash. I'll show you some internal ones here in a second. So I'll show you a couple of these. So we're going to look at Bureau of Land Management. So this, our Bureau of Land Management fights fires out in the West and in Alaska. And so this is showing for 2015 how many fires they fought and how much land was protected. I did this little spark line at the top because I thought it looked like a little flame. But as you highlight that, it'll actually highlight on the map where those fires took place. You can see the number of fires by state as well as the acres. So for example, Nevada had the most fires, but Alaska by far had the most acreage that was under fire. You can click on any state. It will filter your map to a nice zoomed view, so you can look at that. And if you click on any fire, you not only have a little viz in the tooltip that we developed, but you can also click on that fire, and it will load instant information about this one. So this one, they give them funny names. This one's called the soap fire. It'll tell you who detected it, what time. The bar chart that you had seen there actually shows the size of the fire when it starts, the size of the fire when BLM gets there to fight it, and the size of the fire as it is brought under control. So in this case, they were on that one. There's some where the bar goes pretty far. I also found YouTube video, so I thought I would embed this. And it kind of walks through different fire stints. So you don't have to watch the whole thing, but that we're trying to develop a little bit of interest from the public to look at that, and I think this is the way to do it. I don't think anybody's looking at our rainbow pie charts. I'll show you a couple more. Oh, that one, real quick. You may have seen that one before. If you were at the Tableau conference, it was on the big screen during the keynote that the CEO presented. I was in the third row. right back here. Okay, I'll show you another one. This is our Bureau of Safety and Environmental Enforcement. So what you're seeing on the map, each one of those is a oil or gas platform in the Gulf of Mexico, Alaska, or Pacific Ocean. And there's only one in Alaska. And what they wanted to show was regional offices on land. So I have some challenges that a lot of people don't have with maps. They wanted to show regional offices on land. Oil platforms in the ocean have a different tooltip on them. We wanted to size those platforms by oil or gas production. Also show the number of inspections and the fines that were collected from the top companies. So do that on an 800 by 800 screen. I was able to figure out how to do that. So here's the tooltip that you would see. If you hover over a regional office, it will give you information, the address, and information about what that office does. If you were to hover over an oil platform, you will see the complex ID, the structure ID, the number of minerals that it was produced, and the number of MCF, which is the measurement for natural gas. And also, that's the entire footprint so that it can be seen. But up here in this top corner, you can click that, and if you select the oil production, you'll see the map will resize, and the further away from the Gulf are your larger oil producing platforms. Same for natural gas production. I do have a post on our blog about how to do two different tooltips in the same sheet if you ever had that problem. So I'll just kind of flip through these other ones. I won't go into a lot of detail. Everybody likes maps in the government. We have stuff on the middle of the Pacific, and we have Northern Mariana Islands, Guam, Puerto Rico, Virgin Islands, American Samoa, you put that all on a map, it looks horrible, and everybody wants these maps. Last year I had to build 10 maps to build a map so that everything was sectioned off. This year I talked them into let's do a hex map and gave them a lot of reasons why. I could not get away with not giving them a map. I was able to give them a more regional map when you click on the state. So quite a number of fights on that one. This one, we talked about Indian Affairs schools. I did have an Alaska problem here, but I was able to figure out a good solution. There's a post on the blog there. So actually, when you click on Alaska down here, the little Alaska map will disappear. The big map will show Alaska. And so I was able to figure out a solution around that. You can also click on particular schools. For the colleges, it will show you what the types of degrees are offered at each college. It'll give you also their location. And go back to the entire map. If you click on a school, it will actually give you a breakdown of the number of students by grade. So there's a lot of tricks to make our government data look good. we were able to show, these are stream gauges. So this one is looking at all the stream gauges we have in the United States to monitor water flow. Some of these have real-time monitoring. And we have different partnerships. I told you everybody likes maps. This one, if you click on it, really the important thing here is the text. And so I had to come up with a way to make the text pop. And so I figured out how to do that. And so each one of these, as you click through, this is an annotation trick, will actually change the color of the annotation. It'll actually minimize those other points on the map and make them gray and make the points in this partnership stand out larger and the same color as the annotation. So lots of cool little tricks. For VOR, we looked at water and agriculture data. They had a video here about hydropower. So the other important part of their mission is how many kilowatts are we generating at like Hoover Dam and those other power facilities, how many households are served, and how green is that energy. So I'll skip the rest, but there's a couple more out there. It's really interesting. Take a look at it, give me some more views. I can keep building these. And I was really excited to get up on the keynote stage at TC, so that means I think we're on the right track producing content for mass audiences, not just government auditors. So that is things we built for the public consumption. But what about my consumption? I've never presented this in New York, so this is going to be a real treat. All right. This is my very first Tableau Public visualization. I got like 100 of them. This is the first one that I did. And don't judge. All right. So today is Thursday. I want to drink beer on Thursday. Okay, so we just filtered the map to all of the custom brew houses here in Rochester. The big red one is CB Craft Brews out in Honey Lake Falls. So I live down the street, they get the Adam Bump. When you hover over that one, it'll tell you, you know, their address, get some information. If you click on any of these, you're going to see their logo. You'll see their beer drinking hours, some important information there. If you click on the Google map, it will launch you directions to the lat long of the specific group. That's right. Yelp page, directions to the brewery, go back there, links to their website. So what was I doing with this map? Why did I do this? What I wanted to do is I was actually playing with trying to figure out how far is this brewery from that brewery. Let's map our path through the brewery. So let's say, you know, you're drinking, you don't want to go too far. We're driving. So we're going to go 40 miles. So these are now all breweries within 40 miles of custom brew factors. If I were to hover over, say, the BB Brewery in Victor, so that one's only 9 miles. So that's our closest one. Block 32 is 10 miles. But you know, you want to make an informed decision. So you might be wondering what the colors are. That's actually the male to female ratio by zip code. So, drink responsibly. And you can click on anything else. So if I were to pick any other brewery in this data set, it will recenter the map on, say, Fairport Brewing, and now you'll look at all the maps within 40 miles of that brewery. Okay, again, why'd you do that? I sent this to my boss, the deputy CFO at Interior, and I'm like, hey, check this out. And he said two things. He's like, one, I'm presenting in Tennessee, can you make me one in Tennessee? I was like, no, you don't know how long I spent building the data. And, oh, man, lost it again. Sorry about that. And the second thing he said is, why the hell did you do that? There's a really good reason for this. At Interior, we deal with a lot of emergency situations, so think like your Hurricane Katrina's. When that hit, we were scrambling looking for heavy equipment, helicopters, other pieces of equipment to help people, to get people out. We couldn't always find that. It was an emergency situation. People weren't sitting at their computers. They were scrambling around trying to deal with this. Imagine if they had an iPad hooked up to our Tableau server, and they knew exactly where they were, and they typed it in, and they could find all the helicopters or ambulances or fire trucks within a certain radius of where they were. Seems like a good idea. So that is why I was playing with this. Unfortunately, we don't have the data to make that possible, but this was something that I was playing with, that type of idea, learning calcs about lat longs to do that. And now you can plan your year trip. So looking at some more internal data to DOI, to show you kind of some of the things that I started doing at work, taking this information and practice to work. I started to play, I'll play with anything if I read about it. So I went to Tableau Conference, saw R integration, wanted to figure out how to do that. I'm really bad at R, but this one will use R. So this is all of our buildings. We have 40,000 buildings at Interior. Has anybody ever been to Idaho? It's just south of China. And this is Null Island, 00. Okay, so we have a little bit of a problem there. I'm going to click uncheck the ones that are okay there. It's going to, it just sent a query to R running on my computer with the other 10 dashboards that are open and return now. So these are just the problem buildings for all of our bureaus, and you can now see the things in the ocean are a problem. So I show this to the management all the time, and they really appreciate it. But it's the kind of thing that you can't see in a spreadsheet. But when somebody, and nobody ever put it in this light before, but now I can say, this is a problem. We fight fires at these buildings. Maybe we should know where they are. They really, really appreciate that. I'll show you another one. This is some travel data, it's fake travel data. I blended some of our travel data and our trips. We're an agency of 70,000 people for the jaws on the floor. So there's a lot of travelers. And so this is actually, you know, like 6 months of travel. You can clearly see Thanksgiving, Christmas, or I'm sorry, that's Veterans Day, Christmas, every day, or New Year's, so government holidays. You can get a breakdown by bureau. Here, I was starting to play with Robert Roos's pop-out containers. So if you get a data set like that, you want to filter it like 20 different ways. But I also don't want to fill up a quarter of my dashboard with filters. So learning how to do this. You can, with this dashboard, you could click on, I think this is the one that we do it. So we're supposed to take multiple flight paths. Interior. So I first had to figure out our flight paths and airport codes. I joined it with a database of airports around the world so that I could map around the world, travel around the world. And you might not be able to see it up there, but you can now find that this person left Alaska and flew to Seattle. From Seattle, They flew to Amsterdam. From they got the night over in Amsterdam. They flew from Amsterdam to Oslo, Oslo to Kirkenes, worked about a week, flew from Kirkenes back to Oslo, Oslo to Amsterdam, Amsterdam to Minneapolis, and then back to Alaska. There's nothing wrong with this. We have scientists that travel all over the world helping different organizations with, you know, wildlife. But if we are proving, we can prove that we have, we are taking multiple flight paths and people aren't flying direct. You know, you probably can't get a direct flight there, but, you know. Anyway, looking at data in different, smarter, more efficient ways. So what could you do with this? Let's say you wanted to go to a specific airport. So we have a Denver Federal Center. So I can now look at all the flights into Denver. Okay, so a lot of travel happens there. I can now also say, well, just show me the flights that originated from the US. So I have departure flights, I have arrival filters, filters about the traveler, you can type in an authorization number. And so this is a sample dashboard, I'm not actually using it. So this is a different, more smarter way, I think, that we can look at our travel data. So we're currently working on that. Things are not all black backgrounds. I do have white backgrounds for the white background people that are cringing so far. This one there are more child refugees than there are international migrants. One in three children living outside their are living outside their country of birth, and that rate is 1 in 20 for adults. And it's getting worse. You can watch a video, it's even got like videos embedded in the images, if you wanted to. This problem is getting worse. The child refugees under their mandate have doubled in 10 years, and for migrants, it's only gone up 21%. And 2 out of 197 countries make up more than 50% of all the child refugees, so it's Syria and Afghanistan. And these are some of the parts of their mission that they wanted to highlight. So this is talking about how every child should have sustainable, be safe and have sustainable path to migration. And then they had a core diagram. And you can actually hover over these different regions and you can see the flow of migration into where those people have migrated. And this is using great arcs to do that. And you can even focus on a particular country. So if you wanted to focus on Afghanistan, it will load in a new visualization. JavaScript reveal and trying to use slides and different transitions to walk through your visualization instead of a mobile view. This isn't super easy, but I thought this was a really cool presentation for that. So this is, but you get the idea with this one. I don't know why it's a bit after the update. Okay, but I created slides for that. I'm going to show you one that I am working on right now for the next project. This is the Hidden Genius Project. This is revealing, giving opportunities to black youth in Oakland, where they teach them how to code, how to do other computer science techniques. So this is one that I created. All this is Tableau, and using that JavaScript reveal and different Zoom transitions with this. And same kind of thing on your phone, that would go full screen. This would work on your phone.
Your phone that
telling the story through this one. So I'm still working on this, but it's kind of a work in progress. So you can do good as well, which is where I want to get across. It doesn't all have to be stupid visualizations, but once you develop those skills, you can do good with that. Am I doing okay? How much? Okay. All right, so what does all of this do, Tableau? You develop working on these things through the community, building these relationships. You're doing a couple of things. Making all kinds of connections throughout the community. You're able to reach out to these people. So through that Makeover Monday, the forums, these other things, I can now instant message like one of the Zen Masters, and they are more than willing to help, or other people. And people will DM me for help, and I will help them. You guys have the Twitter handle or whatever. You're also building a portfolio of content. So by doing these visualizations, you're able to create content. And this is something that's been on my bucket list for a while, is to create a visual resume. I think if you're gonna work in that field, you should have one. It took me 4 years to build one. But I got crazy with it, and so you can even click this. It would email me right from there. If I click that, please work. And so that will launch an email client, and they'll say, this is your Tableau resume. clicking on the different jobs will load different duties. This is this featured work area that you can build. So you can build out different content for jobs. So part of this is also networking these for in the future. So why don't I have a little more, I'll pause for questions, and we run out of time. But this is something that I've been working on. So if you click on the data to go there, it will load a different gallery of content. Does anybody have any questions or anything at all? I know I showed you a ton of stuff. I can keep going.
Question. First, I want to say I'm just so impressed with everything that you've demonstrated. One of the things is the speed of the visualizations. How do you extract or put the data right out there?
The public ones. Mm-hmm. Most of those are small data sets. I was going to show you one. So most of the stuff I do at work, we work with like SAP Business Objects. I usually process it in Alteryx, so those extracts publish to server. We also have web data connectors where we pull in information as well, but those are also extracts when they go to server. But those we can like refresh daily. The stuff on public is generally pretty small data sets. There's one that I was going to show you Makeover Monday, and it's this one. Maybe two weeks ago, a company named XSL in Germany gave us a live data set of 105 million records. Okay. This is on their public-facing Tableau server. So if you look at the URL, this is not on Tableau Public or on my blog. This is on the public-facing server. And they gave us 105 million records to play with. And so I developed story points walking through this. We are accessing the live 105 million rows on Wi-Fi right now, here on the public Wi-Fi. And it's completely responsive. And so one of the things I noticed were these outliers. This is Chicago taxi trips data that we're looking at. And so people do not travel on Christmas, and they take taxis on the pub crawl. Okay. So that's the analysis I found. And so you can work through these other projects. So I think knowing what data you need is a good question, but part of it is also the technology that you have behind it. You can only do so much with those guys. Yeah. But that one's live, and I think this even has, you know, I did a bunch of different views on that. I think there's a question.
Are you both asked to do visualizations for the interior and look for interior data sets to visualize?
So I work in the accounting office. You only saw a couple of accounting ones, but our deputy CFO is really our champion for this. This was kind of his baby. So I don't have to do much much to get people to want me to visualize it. So he usually loans me out. You've seen I got to look at travel and property and all these different areas that are not accounting. So we kind of have built, we started with that risk metrics, and we kind of built up a reputation of doing good and working with the clients or the, you know, the stakeholders, and developing good content. And so now it kind of flows in. There's a lot that I can't do, but that's kind of the process.
Going focus in on, so you develop the content, is that part of you working with the data owners to check to see, are you doing any data validity?
Yeah, so my WCFO is an owner. He's the data owner of our system. So I do a lot of the data extraction. So I have Alteryx, and I usually have to do that. So just yesterday I had to send some maps to some upper management. I sent them their geo map and I sent them a hex map. They wanted the geo map. But yeah, I give them a whole list of data validity, making sure that what we're producing is right. And a lot went into that public visualization, so that's months of work behind that to get everybody on board to first give me the data, understand it. You know, I'm not a fire expert, so I had to go through a lot of process there to make sure it's valid.
Because your opening point about, you know, a visualization allows you to see things quicker, not until you're visualizing something do you see all these outliers and errors.
Right.
I didn't know if you were the person in the trenches cleaning those up.
I don't get to clean them, but I get to show them. So, like, building one. Like, that's kind of something. I'm like, hey, you guys want these maps? You know, I can map it by postal code.
What do you do about integrating definitions? You know, if there's terms in a visualization that the audience may or may not be familiar with, how do you help them at least understand the definition? Are you doing pop-ups? Are you doing a data dictionary? Are you doing an about page?
Yep. So one of the things that we have here, I've started to do is on these info icons here on every dashboard, so it gives you a little idea about the purpose, the source of the query, when it's going to be refreshed, who the author is. This will email me. There's a couple of reports I developed that don't email me. But some of the more tricky definitions I will build it in. So this one, we happen to have a complex way of developing how we're aging it. So this is a dynamic text, so the date and error will update every month, and it will explain to them what's going on. So if they happen to age instead of by peer performance, they happen to look at activity, I've tried to build those definitions directly into the dashboard. We also work with them when we're developing these, and I do a lot of rollout process. So I probably demoed this one dashboard for an hour, like 4 or 5 different times already. And we also try to build in help. So on our targets tab, I came up with a really unique way to get data out. So everybody always wants the data out. So this one, right now, if you were to come up here and draw a little box around that icon, you really just selected 6,000 items that are a problem. They're all stacked on top of each other. And you can now export all of the data. And so that was a pretty unique way to get to the data because I've got two different TDE files in there with actions. So making sure all of the filters are applied are important. So if I were to look at just this one particular vendor and repeat that process, they now will just get their, I guess that one's only got one record. That vendor's got 14. So this will dynamically update no matter what they click on. They can do any one of these four sheets. They also have the whole menu pop out as well. And I even built a GIF to walk them through that. So this is behind our VPN, so that won't work right now. But if I clicked on that, it would launch our internal Google site, and it would show the GIF walking through that process that I just demonstrated. So we have that. We also, you know, we have some documentation as well. But I try not. I've seen a lot of dashboards on our server that have the front page is the definitions, and that doesn't entice anybody to click on the picture. Put that at the end. Does that help?
Yeah, it does.
Okay. Any other questions?
What's the worst thing you've seen in a visualization from a Tableau functionality standpoint?
I have to educate the rainbow spaghetti charts that I have also been guilty of building, and the 300 slice pie chart is the main my existence. That's also rainbow. Or red and green. So I hope you at least got some ideas here. I can show you, maybe, do I have time for one more?
Yep.
I'll show you. Okay, so I saw this visual, this is more about the community. I saw this visualization on The Guardian. This is every hurricane from like 1850 on. And I wanted to make this in Tableau. And I thought that was really cool. I obviously can't do that map projection, but I thought it would be really neat. So I created this version using the Tableau Pages shelf. And so this is going to animate all of those hurricanes and see if you spot any problems in this data. Whoa, they got hurricanes in India now. So I visualized that and I tweeted Alan Walker, one of the current Tableau Zen Masters, who does a lot with animation. And he's like, call me. So he sent me his number, which I thought was really cool. And I talked to him for, I'm like, this is rare. This doesn't happen. And so I talked to him for a while, and he's like, you know, we could do this a lot better. So we set up a time for him when it was convenient for him, and it, we created this version. So he first walked me through how to run a nearest neighbor algorithm in QGIS, because I couldn't really tell what country those hurricanes were close to. And then he taught me how to use the JavaScript API to animate this. And so I had to build a website, post this on the blog. And so now this will animate those hurricanes, and you can pick a country. It's also fully responsive. So if I were to exit the full screen here, and if it's smaller, you'll see that it will shrink, and it'll be fully responsive. So this is another added benefit to being visible in the community and taking part in that. He knew who I was through the Makeover Monday stuff. And so when I tagged him, hey, let's take a look at this, he showed me that there's a better way to do it. So now I have new tricks. So I think if I'm good, I'll stop there. If you have any other questions, let me know. And I have a couple more postcards up here from the conference if anybody wants them. I think I owe you a doctor session for counting if you want. So,
great.
Thank you very much.